all medications have benefits, but they can also have potentially result in side effects. There is always a delicate balance between the benefits and the risk of taking a medication. Some patients are much more sensitive than others and are prone to these side effects. In this video, I will discuss all you need to know about drug-induced lupus, from what are the most common medications to possible medications and what are the most likely clinical signs that you will experience. I will discuss the types of antibodies seen and if drug-induced lupus is as severe as systemic erythematous lupus.
rheumatologistoncall.com.
Hi, I'm Dr. Diana Girnita, the founder of Rheumatologist on Call. Thank you for watching my YouTube channel, where I talk about autoimmune diseases, but I also educate patients about lifestyle changes that they should take if they want to thrive with arthritis. So don't forget to subscribe and share the channel with people that are in need. Let's begin. What is drug-induced lupus? Drug-induced lupus is a lupus-like reaction or illness that occurs only in some people after exposure to a medication. Lupus is usually known as an autoimmune disease that can potentially target many organs, from your skin to the heart, lungs to your kidneys. However, this is the systemic erythematous lupus. In contrast, drug-induced lupus may be seen as a side effect of one medication. It may occur a few weeks after you start the medication, up to 1 year later. It will appear more likely in elderly adults, more over the age of 50, in comparison with systemic lupus, which usually affects the young adults. What medications can cause drug-induced lupus? Many medications are now known to cause drug-induced lupus, but here are the most common 10 drugs that are frequently associated with this disease. Some of these medications are used for heart conditions, while others are used as antifungals or antibiotics. Here I'm going to list the most common 10 medications that are known to cause drug-induced lupus. Procainamide, which is used for heart arrhythmia. Hydralazine, again used for decreasing blood pressure. Quinidine, it's also used for heart arrhythmias. D-penicillamine, which is used to treat Wilson disease. Isoniazid, which was used to treat tuberculosis. Methyldopa, which is used to reduce blood pressure. Chlorpromazine, which is used to treat some mental disorders. Minocycline, which is used as an antibiotic. Anti-TNF inhibitors, which are used for many inflammatory arthritis like rheumatoid arthritis or psoriatic arthritis. Terbinafine, which is used as an antifungal medication. In 2019, I published the case of one of my patients. This was a 57-year-old wild male with a past medical history of high blood pressure, high cholesterol, that presented with recurrent fevers, chest pain, and shortness of breath. After a few evaluations, it was shown that he had fluid around his heart, he had anemia, and the white blood cells were very decreased. He was treated with anti-inflammatory medication and prednisone for what was believed to be pericarditis. And then he started to develop other symptoms. He was fatigued, he had joint pain, he had morning stiffness, he started to lose weight, he had fevers and night sweats. We did some laboratory testing and that showed that he had persistent of his white blood cells being low and anemia. A deeper evaluation showed that this gentleman had certain types of antibodies that were positive and eventually he was diagnosed with drug-induced lupus, a diuretic called hydroxychlorothiazide. The medication was stopped, he was treated with a short taper of steroids, and later on the patient started to feel better and all the laboratory changes that he had, decreased white blood cells, severe anemia, they became normal again. Now, you have to know that there are many other drugs that could potentially cause drug-induced lupus, but for that, I will include a list here, and I will also include a link in the bottom of this video to my blog where you will find a longer list of medications. This list might not contain all the medications, but it's pretty extensive for you to understand the types of medication that can cause drug-induced lupus. What are the most common clinical signs of drug-induced lupus? The way that the patients with drug-induced lupus present to my rheumatology consultation can vary a lot. However, most patients will describe unspecific symptoms such as fevers or night sweats, unintentional weight loss. Some patients will describe joint pain involving multiple small or big joints. Muscle pain that is diffuse and bothersome can also be present. More rarely, patients present with complaints of chest pain or pain when they take a deep breath. Sometimes patients have to limit their breathing due to chest pain. Some patients are diagnosed with fluid or inflammation around the heart or the lungs that we call pericarditis or pleuritis. Other patients present with rashes on their face, on the chest, or on the back that can come and go or they can be persistent. Very rarely, based on the blood work, patients can present with decrease in their cell counts, like low white blood cells or anemia or low platelet counts. Kidney function is usually normal, but I always check the patient's renal function as kidney dysfunction can be also seen rarely. What are the autoantibodies commonly seen in drug-induced lupus? In rheumatology, we order many laboratory tests. When we suspect lupus or a lupus-like reaction, we order specific laboratory workup. It is important to make a clear distinction between the systemic lupus and the drug-induced lupus. The most common antibodies I see in patients with drug-induced lupus are positive anti-nuclear antibodies or a positive ANA test. If you want to learn more about what a positive ANA means, you can read my blog or you can watch this video in my YouTube channel. However, a positive ANA does not make the diagnosis of lupus. For example, a drug like procainamide can cause a positive ANA test but will not necessarily cause drug-induced lupus. Only 30% of patients that use this medication and had a positive ANA actually develop drug-induced lupus. The second common type of autoantibodies seen in drug-induced lupus are antihistone antibodies. However, these are not specific to drug-induced lupus, and they can be seen even in patients with systemic lupus. The presence of antihistone antibodies can be leading to a drug-induced reaction. The confusion comes when we find another type of antibody that we call double-stranded DNA antibodies. These types of autoantibodies are more specific to systemic erythematous lupus, but they have been rarely found even in patients with drug-induced lupus, especially after exposure to TNF-alpha inhibitors like Remicade or Humira or adalimumab or Enbrel or etanercept. Is drug-induced lupus as severe as systemic lupus? Drug-induced lupus tends to be a more limited disease when compared to systemic lupus. In most patients, drug-induced lupus can affect the skin, the joints, the muscles, and can give patients fevers, but tends not to involve major organs. In comparison, systemic lupus is more aggressive disease, and it tends to affect major organs like the brain, the heart, the lungs, and many times kidneys. You will always need a thorough evaluation to make sure that drug-induced lupus is not involving major organs. To make the correct diagnosis of drug-induced lupus, you need the help of an experienced rheumatologist that will be able to correlate your signs, your symptoms with laboratory workup. This is an educational video that has the role to broaden your knowledge, but it does not offer you medical advice. If you have an autoimmune disease and if you need help, you are very welcome to check out our practice and get the help that you need when you need it the most. Rheumatologist OnCall is a telemedicine rheumatology practice that broadens the access to a specialist in a very short time, when you need it the most, and breaks the geographical barriers. Check out the states where we are licensed to see patients in the United States, and don't hesitate to reach out to us if needed. We are very happy to serve you. Don't forget to subscribe and learn more about arthritis and autoimmune diseases. And also, please share the channel with people in need that will benefit from these educational lectures. Thank you for watching, and I will see you soon.
Rheumatologistoncall.com